الوباء، وهو ضمن محاور برنامج المؤتمر الدولي الذي ينظمه المركز الدولي لعلوم الإنسان اليونسكو بيبلوس بالشراكة والتعاون مع مؤسسة هانس سايدل برعاية وحضور معالي وزير الثقافة القاضي محمد وسام المرتضى. أصحاب المعالي والسعادة، أيها الحضور الكريم، كل التقدير والاحترام والترحيب بكل ضيوف مؤتمرنا الذين قدموا اليوم إلينا من كل مكان ليشاركوا فقرات مؤتمرنا هذا الذي لم يكن ليكتمل لولا وجودكم معنا. أهلا وسهلا بكم جميعا وتقبلوا ترحيبنا. إن الإجراءات الطارئة للحد من جائحة كورونا COVID-19 أثرت سلباً على الحريات الديمقراطية في جميع أنحاء العالم مع تسجيل انتكاسات في شتى أقطار الأرض. وأشار مؤشر الديمقراطية السنوي الذي تنشره وحدة الاستخبارات الاقتصادية إلى تآكل في الحقوق الشخصية فيما يقرب من 70% من 167 دولة تم تحليلها. طالت جائحة كورونا الجميع لكن بشكل مختلف، إذ إن شروخاً قد ظهرت بين الدول وحتى داخل مجتمعاتها تهدد بمخاطر محتملة خصوصاً على الأنظمة الديمقراطية، كما نتج عن أزمة COVID-19 غير المسبوقة تحديات اجتماعية وسياسية اقتصادية وتربوية وقانونية كبرى على مستوى العالم. يكفل القانون الدولي لحقوق الإنسان لكل شخص الحق في أعلى مستوى من الصحة يمكن بلوغه، ويلزم الدول باتخاذ تدابير لمنع تهديد الصحة العامة وتقديم الرعاية الطبية لمن يحتاجها. يقر القانون الدولي لحقوق الإنسان أيضاً بأن القيود التي تفرض على بعض الحقوق في سياق التهديدات الخطيرة للصحة العامة وحالات الطوارئ العامة التي تهدد حياة الأمة يمكن تبريرها عندما يكون لها أساس قانوني وتكون ضرورية للغاية بناء على أدلة علمية، ولا يكون تطبيقها تعسفياً ولا تمييزياً ولفترة زمنية محددة، وتحترم كرامة الإنسان وتكون قابلة للمراجعة ومتناسبة من أجل تحقيق الهدف المنشود. كيف أثر الوباء على الأنظمة التعليمية وما نتائج التحول المفاجئ للتعلم عن بعد، وما هي مناهج التعليم العام للفنون الليبرالية وفقاً لأهداف التنمية المستدامة؟ كيف يمكن إعادة النظر في مبادئ المواطنة وحقوق الإنسان في عالم ما بعد الوباء؟ هل استجابت الحكومات باتخاذ التدابير الفعالة بطريقة متناسبة مع حماية حقوق الإنسان وسيادة القانون في زمن الجائحة؟ ما تأثير الجائحة على ديمقراطيات الاتحاد الأوروبي؟ ما هي عواقب توقف الاقتصاد على المستوى العالمي؟ وما هي أهمية إعادة التوجيه الاقتصاد الرقمي والابتكاري؟ أسئلة سيجيب عليها كل من ضيوفنا الكرام: الدكتورة كاتيا جنيناتي، الدكتور سيمو عبد المسيح، البروفيسور محمد أمين الميداني، الدكتورة هالة عطية، والمحامية ريم المحيسن. أهلا وسهلا بكم. نبدأ مع الدكتورة كاتيا جنيناتي من لبنان، عميدة كلية الفنون والعلوم في الجامعة الأمريكية اللبنانية في لبنان. تفضلي، the floor is yours. Thank you doctor.
Okay, shukran. I'm sorry, but my talk is in English. I hope that's okay. But I hope it's interactive enough so that it's entertaining as well. I'm going to try and manage my PowerPoint from here, so I hope it works. Thank you. So I'm not sure if you can see the slides. Can you dim the lights if you don't mind, like you did in the morning? Thank you. I spent a lot of time on these slides. I wanted to enjoy our beautiful campus. So, I'm from the Lebanese American University. Thank you ever so much for this invitation, Dr. Saliba. Thank you very much for your introduction as well. The title of my talk is A Signature Pedagogy for a Brave New World, which is what we're calling this transition phase. I really don't think we are post-pandemic yet. We're certainly not post-political turmoil. So we feel that there's an imperative right now to adjust our education system in order to allow our students some semblance of success in the world. And I don't know what the future holds for our students, but it's certainly an imperative for us to try and reinvent education. And that's exactly what we've done at LAU. I'm going to present to you a brand new curriculum that will be launching from fall 2022, and hopefully it'll be revolutionary for our students. I tend to talk a lot, and so in order not to overstep my time, I've written my presentation, so this will keep me in check. We're calling our curriculum LAU Insignia, so I'll just present it to you. Here we go. There we go. Did you do that, or did I did it? Very good. Okay. So I'm just wondering how many of you have been teaching this semester. I wonder how many of you have stepped into a classroom recently since September. And how many of you have stared into a room full of students wearing masks, and you're wearing a mask, and you really can't read their faces? You don't know if they're actually engaging with you or not. How many of you have tried to engage students in discussion about food poverty, discussion about wealth, about class, about gender, about politics? And you found out that your first year students simply have no clue about real life because they've been stuck at home behind phone screens, TV screens. All sorts of nonsense has been pumped into their heads. And what they have missed out on is real life experiences of getting in trouble and being late for home and falling in love and having their heart broken and seeing people who are actually poor on the streets. Those students are so deeply immature right now that it is scary to go into a classroom and start talking about Foucault, start talking about politics, let alone get them to engage with each other. My students are scared to look at each other in the eye, because for 2 years now, they're used to closing the camera during their teaching until the teacher says, "Open your camera." They're used to being really comfortable with a cup of tea while they're WhatsApping and you're teaching your heart out online. Certainly, I just wonder how many of you have felt not the frustration, but the sadness that accompanies the realization that these students have been robbed of something that you cannot give back to them. So how is it then that we expect to go back into the classroom, sit down and hit them with theoretical knowledge and expect them to do anything with it? It's simply impossible. Theory is dead. Theory in the classroom is so passé, it's almost criminal to continue the old ways. And you know, in Lebanon, this realization hit us long before COVID. COVID is nothing. We have not had a proper academic year since October 2019. So we've started rethinking education since October 2019, because we knew that when our students went down on the streets and they shouted and watched their parents cry and watched their cousins shouting, screaming. I was there in October. I just arrived to Lebanon, by the way. I arrived in September and I brought the revolution. You're welcome. So I was down there. I was listening to people in tears, shouting their hearts out for change. And then these same students went back home and were told, that's it now, get online and start learning about democracy. It is so paradoxical, and their lives are filled with paradox, and yet the same old curricula are still thrown at them. I think this is completely unsustainable. So in Lebanon, this is not just a COVID measure that we're taking. At LAU, we took into account the fact that the social upheaval has changed our relationship with young people forever, because we are the generation that failed them. And we have to acknowledge that. We have to apologize for our young people, for the world that we're giving them. to compound on the nightmare of the social upheavals that didn't really give us what we wanted, there was total economic collapse, and that was before COVID. Then there was the global pandemic. Then there was the environmental disaster of the port explosion, and there's still continuing political uncertainty. So we had to ask ourselves, what do these students need from us? Looking around, this is what our students see. I know that there's a global problem in education. I'm fully aware of this. But it is so intense in this country that everywhere they look, they will see scarcity, they will see insecurity, and this will lead to a sense of precarity. Precarity about jobs, precarity about the future, and most of them, exactly, thank you for pointing to your brain, but it's just total emptiness. And so what we did is, and this all started in November, we looked for models. Models that can engage students with real world problems, but that have a solid education framework. So we went for the ESD, the Education for Sustainable Development Framework. And we designed a brand new curriculum. Its foundation is on the SDGs. And it's great to do that because it allows us to focus on the local and then progress to the national and look at the global. What a gift to us the SDGs are, because they set also a target, a finite timeline by which the reckoning will come in 2030. What a gift to us to have the United Nations case studies showcasing how patterns of insecurities pervade the world and how we can show students that actually food insecurity is not just a Lebanese problem.